you're joining us here on a new episode of Melt. I'm Ritvika Gupta, and on the show today we'll be speaking to Jane Geraghty. She's the global CEO at Landor, and Peter Knapp, he's the chairman and chief creative officer at Landor. Anant Rangaswami, editor of Melt, joins me today. Hi, Anant.
Hello.
Anant, so you had a conversation with Peter and Jane, and they were pretty optimistic about the branding business. So what was your chat like with them?
First, the issue of optimism came up because I asked them about it. I provoked them into giving me an answer. And, what is clear at the end of the conversation, and hopefully our viewers will get that too, is that while the seeming life of a brand has shrunk, the need for premium branding still remains.
Right.
So there are still people, brands, businesses rather, who attach a premium to the branding exercise and the identity.
Mm-hmm.
And while elements of the business have changed, for example, it takes far less time to create a brand, the need for a good brand and good identity remains.
Right.
And in the course of the conversation, Peter and Jane sort of make the case for their optimism in this view.
Right. There's something very interesting with Jane said, that a brand today needs to be coherent and not necessarily consistent.
Right.
So how far do you agree with her?
No, I do agree with her, especially given the illustrations she shares with us. Now, I thought consistency was a hallmark.
Mm-hmm.
And there were a lot of examples she gave of where you have a large degree of consistency. It's not as if consistency is not important anymore,
mm-hmm.
but an element of coherence comes into it, and that's a kind of latitude that consumers are willing to give brands.
Mm-hmm.
Like she said, when you talk about an Airbnb, for example, the consumer does not necessarily expect the same experience in any Airbnb home or mm-hmm. outlet that they go to as they might expect, say, from a brick and mortar brand such as Taj or Oberoi or whatever. But they expect some level of consistency and a latitude which is left and right of that consistency. And I do agree with her. It's the same as in the Uber case, where you cannot have every car exactly the same, every driver as well behaved or well turned out.
Yeah.
But you still sort of allow latitude, because what you want from Uber is a reliability and consistency
mm-hmm.
in, say, the car reaching you, dropping you to a place safely, and so on and so forth.
Right.
So it is interesting. And I'm kind of convinced with their arguments, and the majority of people that they speak to seem to be.
They also mentioned that they're looking at a long-term relationship with their clients. So do you see this amongst other agencies and brands as well?
Sure. I think the whole branding exercise is going to change. Earlier, a brand or a company, a business,
mm-hmm.
hired a branding agency like Landor and said, work on our corporate identity. And they, did interrogation, they got insights, they mined, and finally after a long, long period, they came and gave you a big fat manual and said, this is the Bible, and you deal with this Bible and you live by it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not true anymore. Things change. The world is a lot more fluid. So I do think that brands will be kind of flexible and changeable. And therefore, the branding agency will have to work closely with the businesses and see that the brand identity is anchored somewhere with some latitude.
Mm-hmm.
Left and right will change, but this will happen continuously. As the marketplace evolves, as competition evolves, as new technologies come in, I think the core of the brand identity will remain, but there will be sort of some give left and right of it.
All right, so let's dive into the conversation. Let's get ready to melt with Jane Geraghty and Peter Knapp.
Hello, Peter. Hello,
Hi.
Jane.
Hi.
So to begin with, what is the future of your business?
Well, I mean, I'm filled with optimism about the branding business. I think that in a world where so many companies are being disrupted by technology and so many brand experiences have the opportunity to be enhanced by technology, the real battleground now comes down to how you differentiate that technology, which is ultimately the brand business, the business that we've always been in.
Right.
So I feel as though the opportunities right now are amazingly exciting, and the future is incredibly bright.
Right. So Peter, you know, you turn the clock back 20 years and people would come to Landor and ask for identity, and at the end of a year or whatever, you gave them a big fat manual and that was it. It's changed dramatically, hasn't it?
It has, and I think what we're seeing now is that brands really are alive. They need to be navigating every day, every week, every month, and changing to suit the commercial context that they're in. So rather than it be a manual that you would refer to for 5 or 10 years, I think now the art of branding is to be agile and to be responsive.
Yeah, so Jane, you know, when we look at a brand like Uber or a brand like Airbnb, I hesitate to call them brands. Simply because, you know, I grew up thinking a brand would give me consistency and would be defined and predictable and so on and so forth. And all these are not. Are they brands or are they businesses?
I think they're modern brands. As Peter says, I think agility is key.
Right.
And I think something like Airbnb, that puts a powerful proposition to the consumer that they sign up to. And ultimately, that means it's a relevant brand.
Right.
So I think, you know, that these are brands that the more traditional brands should learn from.
Right.
I mean, one of the things that we talk a lot about in this modern multi-channel world, a brand needs to be coherent, but not necessarily consistent.
Right.
And I think that the brands like Airbnb and Uber have achieved that.
Right. So, you know, earlier, again, Peter, sticking to what I said earlier, you finished your task by handing over a manual and you raised your invoice, you got a check. But from what you're saying with this agility bit, are we going to see consultants like you working with brands on a continuous basis, perhaps on a retainer, you know, one big lump sum and then, you know, give me a bill every month? Is that going to be what it is?
I think it's absolutely going in that direction. And yeah. The industry needs to react, change the formula, change the game, because we're seeing the commercial world change faster and faster, more than ever so now. So it would be foolish to think that a formula that worked 10, 15, 20 years ago would be appropriate for the disruptive nature of the commercial world today.
Right.
So I think there has to be a way of making sure that the brands constantly maintain relevance to a customer base. A customer base who are looking at thousands of brands every day, making different choices all the time. So for the brands that we work with, the really important thing is making sure that they maintain their differentiation, as Jane said, but also they maintain their relevance, almost on a daily or a weekly or a monthly basis.
So do you engage with them daily, weekly, monthly?
We are most certainly developing longer term relationships with our clients.
And a continuous relationship as opposed to a finite cutoff.
Yes, it is far less, you know, beginning, middle, end, here's your brand bible, off you go.
Right.
And it is much more about using real time data, insights and analytics to inform what the next intervention could be, the joy of technology. There are so many ways that a brand can connect with its audience, using that data to continue to tell that brand story in multiple different ways. So we are certainly seeing clients, which makes me very happy, staying with us for the duration.
Right, so stay with you, Jane. Do you have to rewire your own company now? Do you have to rewire your own company?
Yes,
and
I think we are.
A different kind of skill set.
Yes.
More servicing people. Is all this? All?
Yes, I think we are going through Landor, to be honest, we've always had quite a sort of pioneering spirit. We were the first company, really, to discover modern branding, I suppose. So we're always in a state of reinvention. But I think today's opportunities have most certainly informed an evolved shape to Landor. You know, one of the fastest growing practices that we have right now, insights and analytics, for all the reasons that I've just said. We can continually monitor the strength of a brand. We can quantify the value of a brand. You know, we can predict the outcomes of particular brand activities. These are hugely valuable you know, valuable things for clients today. They really want to know, you know, what the role of brand is and how it can help them propel their business. So we're operating now in a business of brand-led growth. That's really what we're in the business of, and that does require, you know, new skills. And from a creative perspective, we've certainly broadened the skill sets. You know, motion is more important now, I suspect, than it has been. So we have a large motion design team. UX, UI, I mean, there
so
is...
So who do you compete with now?
That's a very good question.
Yeah. So who do you compete with? No, it is broad.
Right. I mean, on the one hand, we are competing with consultancies.
Right.
You know, the insights and analytics capability, the ability to size a market through the lens of brand, that has been something that the traditional consultancies have been owning, but they haven't got the brand lens.
Right.
So on the one hand, we're competing over here, and as we, you know, evolve and expand our creative capabilities, you could argue that we are competing more with traditional communications agencies.
Right.
So, you know, it is rapidly changing.
Peter, you know, your skill sets, all these cost money, your improvement of all your
lucky
internal talent.
Lucky we make so much.
Now, tell me, is the marketer open to a different kind of engagement on, as far as money is concerned, paying you more often? All these are new paradigms, you know, they didn't exist 20 years ago.
Sure.
So how do you cross that path? You know, here in India, which, you know, Lulu knows, you know, if she goes somewhere, you know, competition could have quoted 2 lakhs or 2 crores. I mean, that's a factor of hundreds. How do you navigate that? Because
I think, again, what we see is the field is more fluid than ever. As Jane just described, I think there are different types of consultancies that we are competing against on a daily basis. The client's needs are more diverse than ever. But the one thing that we do maintain is, from how we approach something, if it is based on a really strong strategic foundation, then that has huge value. That is a valuable investment, and one then that you build on for the creative expression. And then we navigate regularly to make sure that the brand is relevant. So there are companies with very different price points, of course. But I think the one thing that we would say is, to build an enduring brand, you have to invest from a strategic point of view, from an insights and analytics point of view, to really understand the marketplace before you then do the creative expression. So it's a question of investment. There will always be people who are cheaper, of course. But you can't guarantee that they will be building such a solid, enduring platform.
So, Peter, can you give me an example of a client that you've worked with who has ticked all the boxes you just spoke about?
I think one of, again, our most enduring pieces of work is for BP.
Yeah.
Right.
When that work launched, it was very disruptive in the marketplace. But we continue to work with them. That's been a 20-year relationship. We continue to work with them to make sure that they navigate all the business issues that they face. And that is a brand who have had significant problems to confront. But we continue to work with them to make sure that they are differentiated, to make sure that the brand is still relevant to their new changing business imperatives. And I think that is something that we have provided a full gamut of services for.
You know, Jane, when Peter talks about you know, brands such as BP, where you had a 20-year relationship, how many brands do you have where there's continuity on the client side? You know, Landor has been consistent for 20 years, perhaps, but you have a CMO who's got a life of a year and a half, maybe 2 years. So who's your stakeholder, and why is it important for you to have consistency of the client side?
Mm. Well, I mean, I think the stakeholder conversation is an interesting one, because, you know, our business has changed dramatically, as I've said, but so have, you know, our clients. So our stakeholders now are much broader than they've ever been before. You know, we certainly continue to have relationships with CMOs. We're increasingly building relationships with chief technology officers, chief culture officers, So I think the breadth of our stakeholders now is increasing. I suppose for us, you know, we have to make sure that one of the bits of value that we add in the equation is the institutional understanding and knowledge about that brand.
Right.
So we are ready and able to accommodate as, you know, clients rapidly change.
Right. Yeah. And the client, the individual you're talking about,
yes.
as opposed to...
Yes. Yeah.
So is there a case, therefore, for all of you to say, we understand your company better than your company understands you itself? You know,
I think
that's probably be true in many cases.
There is an irony that we remain the guardians of the brand despite the changing staff, perhaps, within that company.
Right.
But I think...
Changing CEOs and CFOs and CTOs. Right?
Yeah. But I think we hold an important place to be the guardians of that brand, to be the people who provide a consistency for what the company is trying to achieve.
Right. You know, you invest quite a lot of money, you as in the communications business.
Yes.
And certainly Landor, in Cannes, in going to Cannes, sending people there, sending entities there. What is the value you see out of it?
I think there are multiple sources of value from participating in an international festival of creativity like Cannes. There's no doubt that it's inspiring and rewarding for our people. To win at Cannes gives the whole of the Landor family a real, real boost. So I think there's a huge internal benefit to it. I think continuing on the talent track, it also helps attract fabulous talent.
Right.
And then there's no doubt as well that I think it helps us within the client community to continue to boost our own reputation. Clients do really care about the work that they're doing and they want it to be recognized.
You know, before this interview, we were talking about the kind of clients who win at Cannes.
Yes.
You know, increasingly we're seeing small invisible clients winning from across the world,
mm-hmm.
while the large clients, with a few exceptions, you know, maybe Burger King or a Unilever or something, were,
mm-hmm.
you know, playing the game differently. But is it important that big, real work wins?
I think so. I mean, I think it does matter.
Right.
And I think that, you know, it's hard when there is so much at stake. When you're a big brand and you're going to make a major investment, it's hard to take a creative leap and take a risk. So I think we get especially excited, actually, when we see those big brands winning.
Right. So Peter, you know, Cannes has just got broader and broader as the years, you know, broader and deeper both. Do you think there's a case for saying, let's scrap Cannes from a Landor point of view and create a new festival which is only about design and identity and brands? Not about advertising at all.
Sure.
Imagine.
I wouldn't advocate that. I think
you wouldn't advocate it.
No, because right. I think what we see today is the world is a very complex place.
Right.
The communication mix is very diverse. So it's important to see how brands can exist in all different ways, turning up to markets in different channels, in different guises. So the one thing that is consistent is that big ideas, big meaningful ideas creatively expressed will be successful. They will disrupt. So seeing those ideas in a broadest context as possible, I think has huge relevance and importance. We don't exist just in a design channel.
Sure.
Especially in the outside world. We exist and people consume brands in a myriad of different ways these days. So I think it's important to have a broad context.
Right. So I'm going to close this by putting you on the spot. So tell me the one client you would like to bump into and do an elevator pitch to at Cannes.
Oh, that is a tough one.
You should have thought of it before.
Yes, I probably should have done. I don't know. I think from my perspective, if I were to bump into somebody who evidently had a major brand challenge that, you know, that we could help with, that would make me happy. We do like a big, major brand transformation at Landor. Something really difficult. So
fantastic. All the best, and I hope you had bumped into such a person. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And that was the conversation. Anant, how optimistic are you about the branding business?
No, I'm optimistic because for me personally, I set store by brands. I think brands are very, very important. And I spend a lot of money on brands. I pay premiums on brands because they're brands.
Yeah.
And they promise me certain things. Perhaps I'm a little bit more rigid than the market is as far as brands are concerned. I want more consistency than coherence. But I certainly accept that the larger marketplace today of far younger people will accept the coherence which goes with the consistency. And I think they are right and I'm wrong as far as this is concerned.
And what do you think brands and agencies can take away from this conversation?
Well, I think they should watch this whole interview and say that there has to be a revisit on the way they saw the rigidity of brands, like I saw. And the reason why they need to change their minds is because the consumer has changed. It's not for us to dictate what consumers think. Mm-hmm. And the consumer, if the consumer, he or she is willing to, you know, allow a little bit of width, well, so be it.
Great. With that, it's a wrap on this episode of Melt. You can also watch all our content on our social media platforms. Our handle is Ready to Melt. And I'll see you next week, same time, same place. Goodbye.